Now, we have been talking about the armor of God. We're going to continue our talk. The book of Ephesians. Is that Old Testament or New Testament? New Testament, and it is Paul writing a letter to the disciples who lived in Ephesus at the time. Now, the book, I don't know if you're reading this, but there's 6 chapters, and I've asked you to read 1 chapter a day during the week so that you can get this flavor for why he wrote this letter. So if you would today read chapter 1, and then Monday read chapter 2, and so on and so on and so on, guess what? You'll get to the end of the week, and you're going to have 1 day of rest, just like God designed. So next Sunday, you can start it all over again. But we want you to read that so that you can understand. I'm going to repeat this a little bit because it's very important as a disciple of Christ to know the Word of God, but to know how he's speaking to us. What is the theme of this particular book in the Bible? Well, in the book of Ephesians, the very first chapter talks about our possessions in Christ. That's discussed in the book of Ephesians chapter 1. And he talks about every spiritual blessing God wants to give us. Okay? So we possess things when we come to know him. And chapters 2 and 3 talk about our position in Christ. Fellow citizens. You and I are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. We are part of his family if we've invited him to come into our hearts. And in chapters 4, 5, and 6, it talks about our purpose in Christ. We are to have a walk worthy of our calling. Our calling is to be in relationship with him, and we are to live according to God's word, according to that walk, okay? So he makes it very clear. Now, the armor of God is spoken about in chapter 6 of that book, and in order for us to fulfill this purpose that God has given us, to walk worthy, he wants us to be strong, not wimps, strong. Strong. In order to be strong, we need to know what this says about our walk in our life with Jesus Christ. And after we have put on all of this armor, we are to stand firmly planted. Stand. Stand against the devil. Stand against anything that he's going to send our way. He wants to buckle us. He wants us to be distracted from God. So we need to take a strong stand. After we place all of the armor on us, all of it, we are to stand, okay? So now, let's read this portion of scripture again. I don't want you to get tired. I want you to know it. It's found in Ephesians chapter 6, 10 through 18. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but it is against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. It is not against each other. It is against the devil and what he's trying to do to trip us up. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you have done everything, to stand. He doesn't want us sitting on the job. He wants us standing. Amen? Amen. Stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all of this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the saints. Excuse me while I take a drink. He has given us some precious gifts. Precious possessions. Possessions we possess. Given by him, given to us. He's given us truth. He's given us the church. And the church just doesn't sit right here. There's many word churches all over the world. That's the church. He's given us his word. He's given us his grace. He's given us his salvation. He's given us his blessing. Do I hear an amen? Amen. Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. God is a giver. And the devil wants all of it. The devil wants all of it. He will stop at nothing to take everything that we have been given by the Lord if we let him. He can only take what we give him. Remember that. Remember that. That's why we have to take our stand. Do you understand that? We have to be strong. We have to understand that God has given us these possessions. And we're not to just sit back and relax and let the world go by. We have a job to do, and we are in a war. We are in a battle. We are to use the equipment God has been giving us for a purpose, and it is to stand against the devil, because he wants you to be so distracted that you aren't going to help people come to know him. You are going to be so distracted and so busy that you're not going to have time to share. You're not going to have time to serve. Do I hear an amen? Because, guys, you need to know this. If you don't know this, the devil is going to knock you down, have his way with you, and you will become ineffective. Okay. Do you understand that? Yeah. We need to be strong. We need to be equipped. We need to be alert, okay? The belt of truth refers to this. This is a life of total commitment to the Lord in his word. Now, when we know this truth, it's revealed in us. It's revealed in what we say and speak and how we live and how others see us live and conduct our lives. Okay? It is a total commitment to that. Truth in what we say and truth in how we live. Without the belt of truth, the soldier of God will find the other pieces of armor useless and ineffective. We need the truth. The truth is right here. If you don't know this truth, you're not going to be able to stand. And really, the other things are going to become completely useless. Now, the other thing is the breastplate of righteousness. And that refers to the power of a holy life, a life made right with God. We learned this last week. If we have invited Jesus into our hearts, and we have a personal relationship with him, and we're made right. We're made righteous with God. We are then called to a life dedicated to holy living, because it says in 1 Peter 1:16, be holy as I am holy. Doesn't say be perfect, it says be holy. That means the free will that you have, you get to choose how to live. You get to choose who your friends are, who you're going to listen to, what your eyes see, how it gets filtered. You get to choose that. You also get to choose to obey the living God. Do I hear an amen?
Amen.
Amen. Be holy as I am holy. Today we're going to talk about shoes of peace. Feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. Now, I think we take shoes for granted. We have different shoes for nearly every kind of activity today. Dress shoes, casual shoes, work shoes, walking shoes, shoes for this, shoes for that. I have more shoes than my husband, but don't tell him. Okay? What I plan to do for the day or what I plan to wear dictates what shoes I'm going to wear. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Different possessions require different footwear. Steel-toed boots for the construction workers, cleats for football and baseball players, and so on and so on. Has anyone been watching the Olympics like I have been? I notice shoes. I notice shoes. There's been a lot on track and field lately. And the color of shoes, the style of shoes, the make of shoes. These athletes spend thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars, even in their training years, all the years that they've been training. And then in this one day, this one shot that they have, those socks need to be right. Those shoes need to be right. They need to be laced just right. I'm telling you, everything makes a difference in your footwear when you're an athlete. And you need your feet to do this. I have run a couple of half marathons before. Where you place your shoelaces, where you place that little chip, microchip, on your shoe, how it hits when you're running, all of that makes a difference. All of it makes a difference. Your feet and how you prepare them makes a huge difference when you're competing in these competitions. As important as shoes are to an athlete, they're even more important to us as a soldier in God's army. Soldiers need to be prepared to go long distances, run sprints sometimes, experience all types of environments, wet terrain, rocky terrain, burning hot ground, snow, uneven terrain. I'm talking about us in our regular lives, guys. Our feet need to be fitted properly with the shoes of peace, or we're not going to run our race very well or effectively. Are you getting it? You understand? Okay. Some hindrances: injured feet, swollen feet, a corn, a bunion, toe fungus. All these, too long, your toenails are too long, they're too short. Blisters, all these kinds of things affect the feet of an athlete, but they affect the feet of a soldier as well. Okay? All of these make a difference, and they can hinder you. These injuries cause the soldier an inability to stand and move, and they may affect his ability to utilize his weapon for protection and advancement in the battle. All of this makes a difference. We need to protect ourselves. Feet, our feet need to be prepared. Okay? The Roman soldier wore leather shoes that protected the feet and ankles. These shoes, here is a picture of them. These shoes of peace, they're called a caliga, caliga. They were a half boot that allowed the soldier to advance toward the enemy undistracted about what they might step on. This shoe also gave them great traction for whatever terrain they were on. They were made of leather. They were perfectly fit to his feet. Okay, but you know what? I think I've seen a shoe like that at Designer Shoe Warehouse the last time I was there. Very pricey. No. But anyway, they aren't so much a shoe or a boot. They are kind of a type of sandal. Now, the bottom, you'll see the bottom has stuff in there. And what they used back in the Roman times, they had hobnailed soles, which means they had bits of metal nails driven through them. And that's what gave them the traction and the stability. Shoes of peace. When I think about shoes of peace, I think about two things about peace. I think about peace received from God, and I think about peace to be given from us to others. We're going to talk about each one of these. And this is really critical. Think about this for a minute. Peace received from God. When I think about that, I always look at the cross. I think about, it's a vertical. I think about that vertical line. God to us. God giving us peace when we've invited him into our heart. That's the peace I'm talking about. The cross beam going horizontal is the peace we are to give to the world, to the lost. Okay? Whenever I think about stuff like this, I always think about God's relationship with us and our relationship with others on this earth. Okay? And you know what that also correlates with? Is the two greatest commands that were given in the New Testament. To love God with all of our heart, all of our mind, all of our soul, and all of our strength. Amen? Amen. Amen. And then, the second commandment, love others more than you love yourself. Okay? That's the same thing. Loving God, loving others. Think about that. Have that picture in your mind. This is a great visionary for you to have this week while you think about it. Peace received from God is when we enter into a personal relationship with God, holy God, through Jesus Christ. Remember last week when we talked about the breastplate of righteousness? Okay, we talked about that's when we are made right with Him, when we've invited Christ in, when we know that we are sinful, we cannot save ourselves, we need a Savior, and God sent Jesus. And we opened up our heart and said, come in and wash me clean from my sin, because I can't wash me. I can't get myself clean. And it takes the blood of the Lamb to cleanse us from our sin. Jesus is the Lamb of God. We, sinful man, made right with Him, holy God. That's when we receive His peace. When we are not only made right with Him, but at the same time, we've been washed clean, and we have been given an incredible gift of peace. In the midst of this chaotic world, when I was 17, walking to a football game on a Friday night, and I opened up my heart to Jesus and said, I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know how this is going to change my life. I know I can't do it on my own. Jesus, come into my heart and cleanse me from my sin. And immediately I felt just cleansed and pure and full of peace. Full of peace. Even in the midst of a teenager's chaotic world. Okay? Here's what I mean. This scripture from John 14. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled. And do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. And this peace does something in us. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. He guards your hearts and minds. This peace protects our hearts and our minds. This is what happens when you invite Jesus into your heart. Peace, not confusion. Our God is a God of peace. He is not a God of confusion. Amen? Amen. Amen. Remember the fruits of the Spirit found in the book of Galatians? Love, joy, peace. Peace. When you are living a life filled with the Holy Spirit of God, you are filled with peace. And if you're living full of peace, and it's a work in progress, it doesn't just happen like that. It is, you will see your life begin to change. Your reactions begin to change if you are fixed and surrendered to Him. Amen? Amen. The peace comes, the joy comes, the love comes, the patience comes, the faithfulness, the gentleness, all of those things, the self-control, they all come. That is found, write this down, Galatians chapter 5, 22 through 25. Read all of those verses. It's beautiful. Love, joy, peace. That's what being in relationship looks like. Now, the second part. We have received this peace from God when we enter into relationship with Him. Now what do we do with it? Remember, we don't sit back. There's something we need to do. We need to be giving it out to others. This is our call, disciples. We can't just sit back and know that we're heaven-bound and do nothing. We need to be about the Father's business. We need to be about seeing the lost in the hurting world, our relatives, our co-workers, people who are hurting, and we are to take Jesus to them. We are to be peace givers. We are to be peacemakers. This is part of the Beatitudes, the Sermon of the Mount, Matthew chapter 5. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children of God. Now, if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, and you know it, and you're heaven bound, and you're involved in doing some good things, but you are a pot stirrer. You know what I mean by pot stirrer? You know what I mean by that? That is a person who likes to cause trouble and dissension and gossip here and there. And we are to be peacemakers everywhere we go. It's okay to ask questions, but it's not okay to divide the church of God. It's not okay to divide brothers and sisters. We are to be peacemakers, peace givers, because we serve the Prince of Peace. Amen? This is also what the Great Commission is all about. This is a responsibility to be a peacemaker, a peace giver, to bring peace into this world of chaos. Because in Matthew 28, 19, and 20, familiar to many of us, therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age. The word I want you to circle in your sermon notes is go. We need to go make a difference in this world. We need to go bring peace to the world. We need to go and bring Jesus to the world. We need to notice the lost, the hurting, the bruised, the wounded, the angry, the people who have no hope. And we need to go and share Jesus with them. Mentor them, disciple them, take time, invest in them. Invite them to church functions. Invite them to church. Invite them to a small group. Invite them to coffee. Invite them into relationship so that as your relationship with them grows, the crossbeam, you can introduce them to the one who can save them. Amen? Amen. Do you understand? Do you understand? This is twofold. We receive peace. We are to give peace. God does this by us sharing our story. Now, I want to tell you, I was recently in the doctor's office, and I'm part of the Dignity Mercy health system. And while I was sitting in the waiting room, I noticed this little orange thing. If you're part of the Dignity health system, you probably noticed it in their waiting rooms. It's called the healing power of stories. When you have to make decisions about something as important as your family's health care, it's reassuring to read about the experience of others. Sharing your personal experience can be powerful medicine. This is the world's view, and the Lord, I think they stole that from God, because that's God's way. Do you know He uses you and your story? And He uses you and your story and you and your story to tell the people that God has brought your way about Jesus. We all have a story, and our stories are different. Jesus is the same. Our stories and our adventure and our experience with Him is different. We all met Him at different times for different reasons over different circumstances, but we met Him and we surrendered our hearts to Him. He wants you to go tell your story. If you're keeping your story to yourself, you're ineffective for God's kingdom. You're not growing the kingdom. That's not part of the Great Commission. So you need to tell your story in bits and pieces. As Pastor has said this before, when the question comes up and the conversation goes a little bit deeper and you have an opportunity to maybe tell somebody, I will be in prayer for you. I will pray for you. Huge difference. That makes a huge difference. That's personal. Then you got to go do it, okay? Telling your story, your personal story, because that's what God has given you. That is why we have to have ready feet. Ready feet pertains to this. You need to be ready in season and out of season to tell people your story, because you don't know what's going to happen. How many of us have heard the story of so-and-so was in church and he left and he was in a car accident and he lost his life? Several of my kids in high school and grade school, their friends have lost their lives in car accidents or certain circumstances, and they don't have an opportunity to hear the story anymore. Don't waste an opportunity to share your story, because you don't know how long that person is going to be on your path at that moment. You don't know if that's ever going to happen again. Share your story. You will feel the prompting. You will sense the Spirit of the Lord prompting you to go ask one more question. Open, go through that open door. Don't waste an opportunity. Amen? This is what God says about ready feet when it comes to sharing the good news of Jesus' love. How beautiful and delightful on the mountains are the feet of him who bring good news, who announces peace, who brings good news of good things, who announces salvation, who says to Zion, your God reigns. He uses us, and our feet are beautiful if we're ready and prepared. We need to be ready and prepared to tell our story. Amen? Amen. God wants us to be ready and prepared to share the good news, the gospel, with other people. But in your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect. I met a man at Sam's Club when I was checking out at the grocery store. I've seen him many times. I talk to him every time. And it was busy, and it was right before, I have a business thing, so I get to go early in the morning. This particular time, I went right before 10 o'clock. I was checking out at 10 o'clock when they opened the doors to the rest of the people, and it was really getting busy, and everybody was lining up at the cash registers and stuff. And I met him. I always look at their name badge, and like you guys, when you wear your name badges here, it's so nice to be able to call somebody by name, and I called him by name, and I said, how you doing today? I know he works two jobs, and I keep telling him, I'm praying for you so that you have strength to work so that your family can have provision. Because you guys just look so tired, you know? And we entered into a conversation. He saw from my Sam's Club membership that I'm part of a church. And he asked a question about the church. And he did it under a whispered breath. It's like he needed to be careful about what he was saying. I didn't know if that was because, the company frowns on that or whatever. But he says, what religion are you? And I said, well, I'm one of the pastors at the Church of the Nazarene. And I said, we're a Bible-believing church. We meet at Midtown. I said, you might want to come check us out. We're at 28th and Us. And he said, you could tell he was just kind of struggling. I said, what is your religion? Muslim. And he didn't want anybody else to hear that. But before I left, he pulled out extra paper from the register, and he says, write down the time you meet. That is the next question. Do you see what I'm saying? Wait for the next question. It wasn't a time of just greeting, checking out, leaving. God opened the door for another question. I pray that he comes one day. And the next time that I see him, maybe God will open another door for another question. I'm praying for him to want to ask more questions. I'm praying for the Holy Spirit to soften his heart. Okay? Isn't that beautiful? That's the way it is. That's the way God works. It isn't all at once, and boom, they're at the altar and they're saved. It's in process. It's in relationship. He's beginning to trust me. And God is having me trust him. Do you understand? Okay. When God saved us, he commanded us to tell others what he has done for us and what he can do for them. Then he said, go into the world, go everywhere, even Sam's Club, and announce the message of God's good news to one and all. Whoever believes and is baptized is saved. Don't you want to be part of that? There is no greater feeling. And I don't like to base things on feeling, but there is a wonderful feeling when you've led someone and you've prayed with someone to receive Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. That is a beautiful thing. More of us ought to know what that feeling feels like. He has given us his Spirit who equips us for this sharing. This is what evangelism is called. That's a church word for sharing your story. Sharing your story of what Jesus has done in your life. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria and to the ends of the earth. This was after the Jesus' death and resurrection, and before he went up into heaven, before his ascension. He is telling the disciples, I'm going to use you, I'm going to equip you, the Holy Spirit's coming. And you know what? We have the Holy Spirit. Yippee skippy, we are filled with the same Spirit of God that raised Jesus from the dead, amen? That's power. And if you think you don't know what to say, or you don't think you know the Bible well enough, just let him use you. Let him use you, be willing. He's going to use you, okay? With the belt of truth, with the breastplate of righteousness, and now our feet are fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. God is equipping us to be right with him and to be ready to share our story of God with others. He's equipping us for the battle against the devil. And I find this extremely freeing. I find it exhilarating. I find it challenging. There are too many people in this world who have no hope. Every one of us knows somebody that has no hope. We have hope in Jesus. Share the hope we have in Jesus. The hope of forgiveness. The hope of love and acceptance. And the hope of eternity with the God of love. Amen? Amen? That's what we are called to do. Let's pray.